5 seconds. Sir, many points have been raised in regard to this bill by the honorable members. I think that all the points which have been raised by them can be replied to at the stage of consideration of the bill. I am certain that I have enough material with me with which I will be able to satisfy the honorable members. Of course, as a matter of fact, I know that the honorable members who are in the trade union activity will oppose the bill. That is why I am present in the house. First of all, I have not been able to understand whether there has been a concept appreciation of the provisions of the bill. On the last occasion also, the very same arguments were put forth. I can understand collective bargaining, but I do not know whether it is a fundamental right to go on strike. The matter was taken to the court to consider whether this was a fundamental right. There is a judgment of the Supreme Court in which they have said that nobody, especially when it is a matter of supply of essential commodities and if the production is going to be affected, can claim that he has a fundamental right to go on strike. Then there seems to be a wrong idea about another issue, as if there is a total loss of all the rights which the trade union leaders have been enjoying so far. I think my honorable friend has rightly said that this is an enabling provision and is not contrary to the Industrial Disputes Act. At the same time, the Industrial Disputes Act can be invoked if we find that in spite of the standing machinery to bring about reconciliation between the different parties, it has totally failed. But I think you will agree that essential commodities for the common man are a necessity. If it is going to affect the very people for whom we have taken a pledge that we will be supplying the essential commodities, then only the provisions of the Act can be invoked. It does not mean that we cannot have a machinery of conciliation so far as the government employees are concerned. It is true that they cannot be invoked. We have tried our best. In spite of the fact that attitude of some of the people was not reasonable, we did not invoke the provisions of the Act. If the honorable member is interested in the matter, I may give the instances of how many times the provisions of the Act have been invoked. The information I have is that over a period of 5 years, it is only 30 times, and that too in matters which are considered very basic and essential, that the provisions of the Act have been invoked. I may inform the House that before taking a decision about the amending the provisions of this Act, we have also consulted all the state government. I may say that most of them have recommended that the provisions of the Act should be extended. Now, I may point out that this provision is required for continuing or maintaining the essential services to the community. In fact, there is no question of the government of India being against the working class or against collective bargaining. I fully agree with the view, but I believe that even the working class will appreciable that where no fundamental right is involved, it has every right to agitate or resort to collective bargaining. But at the same time, where it is a question of supply of essential commodities to the common man, and if his life is to be affected by any action that it is going to take, I do not think that the working class is against this measure. There can be no conflict between the interests of the common man and the interests of the working class. But at the same time, if there are people who are trying to create conditions by which whatever essential services are being rendered are going to be affected, I do not think there will be sufficient justification for them to do so. I may point out that this is applicable not only in the case of the working class when they go on strike, but also to lockouts which have been declared by the owners of some of the industrial units. In both cases, it is applicable, and that is why these provisions can be made use of in such cases. One honorable member said that there was a provision to tackle matters of this nature in the National Security Act and others acts. I think it will be remembered that we have been maintaining the position that the provisions of these acts are not to be used against any of the legitimate trade union activities which are being carried on. That is why we have given clear guidelines that the provisions of these acts cannot be invoked against the trade union activities. The Essential Services Maintenance Act is specially meant for the supply of essential commodities to the community at large, and that is why a special provision is made in this bill. I think these are the main issues involved as regards other points when the bill is considered clause by clause. The honorable members may state their views and I shall reply to them.